Okay, yes, perfect. Sir. Okay, so you know, we had had two sessions till now on this topic. We talked about you know, the whole feelings that you have, what SSB is. We had taken you through what happens maybe for every candidate once they receive the call letter, how you suddenly find yourself in a tight spot when you have to prepare, and so many things to work on. And you know, the stage one part, how it is so important, the 4-day tests. Then we had talked about, you know, how we are going to help you in terms of this analogy of the blind man and the elephant. And we had explained to you that our goal through our guidance methods is to see that each one of you is able to see the full elephant and not be like the six blind men in Jeffrey Sachs' poem. We had talked about the different myths and rumors. We had taken you through them. Then we had given you this context of the importance of, you know, not getting confused and having a very, very clear idea of what the SSB looks for, using this analogy of Krishna and Arjuna during the Mahabharata. And then we had talked about the difference between armed forces and the corporate world, where we had discussed in length about, you know, how working conditions are different, how physical and mental requirements are different, and hence the importance of a very robust selection process followed by a very hard training in the training academies. So from here on, you know, we will discuss about the selection procedure. And even this part we had discussed, that we are not looking for individual brilliance. It does matter, but only to a limited extent. More important for us is your ability to play in a team and a certain set of qualities, or what in psychology you call as traits in the personality, that we are trying to evaluate when we are selecting you.
Sir, any real life example if you can give from your service experience about explaining the group dynamics and individual brilliance?
Sorry, Harsh, you are a little low. Can you speak a little louder? What are the questions?
Hello. Sir, can you give your real life example from your own service experience wherein you experienced both the things, individual brilliance and group dynamics at the same time?
Sorry, where you experienced?
Individual brilliance and group dynamics both at the same time.
Individual brilliance and group dynamics both together?
Yes, means at a particular point of time, you might have to choose between both of them. And then how did you overcome the particular situation?
So Harsh, I think, you know, I don't look at it like that. I think, you know, in our selection procedure itself, okay, we look for people who are not so much focused on individual brilliance at the cost of teamwork. Please understand, that is how you should interpret.
Okay.
Okay, your individual
brilliance
at the cost of teamwork. Okay.
Okay.
I think you always look at it in that context. So if I'm someone, if I get someone who is individually brilliant and is still able to play in a team environment, absolutely, okay, we'll hire that. We will select that the candidate. But okay, if I get someone,
sir, exactly, who is
technically individually brilliant, but is not able to maybe gel well in a team or doesn't understand what it takes to be a team member, maybe the person is highly likely that they get rejected in the selection process. So we are not saying that individual
brilliance is not. Add this. Yeah, hello, Samir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, Samir.
Yeah, it, Harsh, this was your doubt. I'll just clarify it also further, sir. Further to what sir has said, individual brilliance means there is no harm in you being individually brilliant person. But till the time you are not able to adjust with the group or listen to the smallest of the ideas that have been given by the smallest of the person, and you are ready to change your own, that is what is required. Because sometimes I have seen, when I was doing actual mind laying also, some of the most brilliant ideas were given by the lowest people on the ground. who was just a jawan, but and ultimately that idea happened to be so strong that it was followed by the entire Indian Army. So when I was actually doing my mind laying, one of my jawan suggested one method. He, why don't we start the way in the reverse process? The book says you have to do it in this way. But looking at the situation, he suggested, why don't we do it in a different way? We start the fencing first and then start laying the mines. And I also thought there is some sense in it. I followed it. So initially my seniors, they also, they were not very happy with I breaking the procedure. So they scolded me also.
Okay.
But within thing, when the accident started coming in, they realized that this is the best way to avoid an accident. And the order came from the entire army headquarters for all the units.
Okay. Exactly, sir. That was the exact doubt which I asked. I got it clarified. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Samir, you want to take on this slide also?
Yeah, the current slide, the test and an assessment. Okay, see, there is a big difference between what is done in the SSB and what is done in the other tests that you go and appear for any competitive exams. Here it is an assessment. That means, first of all, there is no syllabus. The assessment, the syllabus, in fact, you can say is your own personality, which doesn't have any bounds. So there is no fixed syllabus. And the most important is there is no correct answer for anything. There is no single answer which can be right. So here, if I see, you can give me a different answer, Manoj can give me a different answer, but both of them can be correct. Although the answers are different because there is no single answer which is correct here. So never try to copy any guide or copy any answers from any guide which has already given you some answers or have a template for this. Your answers will be based on your own personality. If it matches with your personality, you will do well in the exam. You will score more marks. If it doesn't match, even if the response is very good, if it doesn't match with your personality, you will not get marks in the SSB. Understood? So you're clear about the difference between a test and assessment?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So they are simply called as test because it is easy to understand. See, there is a lot of confusion about SSB as it is in the outside world. There is not enough clarity ki what type of tests are conducted, how they are conducted, especially for people from village background and all, it becomes very difficult. So if I start calling it as an assessment, it will become more difficult. They will have more queries. And so in the verbal language, they say ki psychological test, but actually it is not a test. It is an assessment. Okay. So what is going to actually happen in the SSB is it is just going to be a game that you are going to play, a game of stimulus as well as response. So the SSB people will give you a stimulus and they will expect a response from you. Okay. In the psychological test, what is the stimulus? The word shown on the screen is the stimulus. Whatever sentence you write is your response. In the TAT, the picture is the stimulus. Whatever story you write is the response. In the interview, the question itself is the stimulus. Understood? And in the GTO task, the task itself are the stimulus. So what you do in the task is your response. So indirectly in the SSB, it is just a game of stimulus and response that you all are made to play. And based on your response, the thing that is being judged actually is your individual personality. Understood about this?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Take you to the next one, Samir.
So we can go to the next slide. Then what do you understand by personality as such? Okay. So there are a lot of terms, definitions about personality. Somebody will say personality is attitude. Somebody will say personality is your behavior. Okay. So it all adds up to your personality. These are all traits. But your basic or whatever is the basic set will never change. Okay. So this personality is being judged in the SSB. And in this picture, like we see the Akshay Kumar has been shown. Does he have a good personality? Yes or no?
Yes.
He definitely has a good personality. He's looking. He's good looking. He's got good features. Okay. And we can say that is also a part of the personality is your appearance also. But primarily in the SSB, what they are trying to find out is not how you look from the outside, but how you are from the inside.
Inside.
That's the personality they are trying to find out. So in all the three techniques, you will find the GTO, the psychologist, the interviewing officer, he's trying to judge by your answers or whatever you have written, what is actually going on in your mind. They're trying to find out what is your actual personality form inside, whatever your response might be. Okay, and depending on the response, they are trying to judge your personality based on 15 qualities. Okay, now how we arrived at this 15 qualities is also a long story. What they did is in the armed forces many years back, they told all the people to write down what are the qualities they want to see in their leaders. Also, they asked all the people who are the leaders, what are the qualities you would like to have in your junior? And they made a list of all the qualities. So total 225 qualities came out. And out of that 225 qualities, then they started reducing it, combining it. Because it is not possible to judge 225 qualities in such a short time. So finally, the Indian Armed Forces, they honed on to 15 qualities, which they found that these are the main qualities which should be there in the individual and we would like to judge. And these 15 qualities are then divided into qualities of the head, qualities of the heart, leadership qualities and your dynamic qualities. Because a total of all these things will ultimately make your personality and they will be able to judge your personality. Understood? So that means indirectly the armed forces is looking for nothing different. They want a person who should have little bit of brains, who should be good at heart, who should be able to take a leadership role at times, and who should be physically also good, who should be dynamic in life. Simple. Condense what is the armed forces looking for. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Take you to the next one, Samir.
To the next slide. So these are the head, the qualities, heart, the leadership qualities and the dynamic qualities, that is as it is shown on the right side. What is shown on the left side is what the assessors do. The people who are judging you, who are giving you marks, they have divided this into various factors. Okay, factor 1, 2, 3 and 4. So they are trying to find out whether your experience factor, your planning, organization is okay. Whether you are able to socially adjust in a social environment. Whether you are able to be effective socially in a group, you are able to prove your effectiveness, and finally, whether you are dynamic in nature. Okay? Yes, sir. Next. Now we'll go to the qualities of the head. Now, there are four qualities: effective intelligence, reasoning ability, organizing ability, and power of expression. Now, these are the first. Top four qualities, which are qualities of the head. Okay. Now, if you see, reasoning ability is one of the most important quality out of this four. Okay. For every quality, you require reasoning. Even if you have to do organizing anything, the reasoning will come into action. Effective intelligence is what? It is getting a solution, a practical solution to your problems. You can only get a practical solution when you have got the reasoning ability, when you can reason what are the options available, what is the right option, follow. Okay. So reasoning ability is called as the mother quality in the SSB. It is given the most weightage out of all the 15 qualities that are shown. So nobody can clear the SSB without having a little bit of reasoning ability. Is it clear? And effective intelligence is the practical way of doing things. You might be having the basic intelligence. You have the degrees. You have the qualifications. You are able to apply whatever. You are able to score good marks in your exams. That is different. That is basic intelligence. But effective intelligence is how you are able to make use of this basic intelligence to solve day-to-day problems. So you will always see in the SSB, you will be given a lot of SRTs. It is given in the interview also. It is also given in the psychological test. That is just to check your effective intelligence part. Okay, how effectively you are able to solve a situation. In the GTO part, the outdoor task, that is where the effective intelligence come out. Okay, how you are able to apply with limited resources, how you are able to get a solution. Okay. And organizing ability, you all know, a little bit of organizing capability should be there. We all keep doing it in our daily lives. You organize yourself for studies. You even organize your table. Okay, you have a timetable to study. That is nothing else but organizing ability. And lastly is power of expression. Now, one thing is very important. Here it is included in the quality of the head. And why is it included? Can anybody tell me why power of expression should be in the quality of the head?
So, because if you don't have enough things to speak in your head, you cannot express it properly.
Correct. Very rightly. Whatever you speak, first get form in your brain. Right. And only then it comes out through your mouth, whatever you want to convey. But the first impression is always formed in the mind. So expression, although it is related to speech, but still it is included in the qualities of the head. Why it is very important to have a good power of expression? Can anybody tell me, Manoj?
So we need to influence the group at times. So it is important.
Okay, good. Ajinkya, anything you feel?
Sir, expressions show more emotions towards from our speech. They give up more information to us what we are speaking.
Yeah, a very common question sometimes they ask in the interview. Okay, they will say ki you have to lead a commando attack like Uri. Okay, you are detailed to go across into Pakistan and carry out a raid. And there are five people given to you, all from different parts of the country they have reported. How will you greet them? So that shows ki the way your power of expression is, ki how you are able to manage and have an impact on the group. Okay, so power of expression is very, very important, because in the warlike situation, can you imagine what would be happening there? You will not be able to see the person in front of you. There will be so much of dust, smoke, people will be spread out at different places. There will be so much of noise. There will be firing going on everywhere. Bombs would be there. And in that, you have to convey what you have to say clearly to your men. Because if they are not clear, and if your power of expression is weak, you will never be able to convey anything. And it might lead to some misunderstanding and a lot of misconceptions later. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
We'll go to the next slide now. The qualities of the heart. Okay. So the first quality is adaptability. Why adaptability is important? Can anybody tell me, say Pardeshi, yes, can you tell me a little bit ki, why do you think you have to be adaptable in the armed forces?
If we are adaptable, then there is a different situation and different terrain we have to go. So we must adaptable with the environment, with the men also.
Very good. So good. Nicely brought out. See, adaptability is one quality which is very, very highly required in the armed force.
Yes.
So when you actually get selected also, when you join the academy, the first thing they will do is, since all of you are from different backgrounds, somebody is coming from a very rich family, somebody is coming from a poor background, somebody has already been a leader, he has been the best in the class, always the monitor and all. So there are different backgrounds, people who are joining the academy. So in the first term, what they will do is, they will try to make you all zero or come into one mold. So you might be from any background. First, they will make you zero by way of group punishments, together punishments, so that you realize that I am nothing. And then slowly they will start lifting you up together. And that bonding and that adaptability will then come. I'm sure Commander Jog might tell you, in the course split, like I passed out in 92 from the academy, Indian Military Academy. So all the people who passed out in 92 are my coursemates. And this bonding is so high ki even today, if I just give a call to anybody saying ki I am 92 batch, I need help, I am at so and so place, I am sure all the people who are there nearby, they will all drop in. That is a very high level of course spirit that you will always find. Why? Because we all have done the training together. I don't even might not be knowing their names or even not seen them earlier, because you don't meet everybody in the academy also. There are so many people training. But adaptability is very, very important. The team spirit is very, very important. Okay, and you have to adapt not only to people, you have to adapt to situations, you have to adapt to weather. Sometimes the weather is not against you. Sometimes the climate will be against you. Sometimes the people whom you are going to operate will be against you. They will be pelting stones and all, but still you are supposed to perform your task. So adaptability becomes suddenly very, very important. Then of course, cooperation, sense of responsibility. Why responsibility is required? After you become an officer, what is the status that you all will be called? You will be called as what officers?
Commissioned officers.
Yes, sir.
Commissioned officers. Yes, very good. So what is the meaning of the word commissioned? Are you aware of that? Because you are going to become commissioned officers.
In charge.
Anybody?
Officer who is in charge of the in charge of something.
Yes, in charge of something. I just tell you, you should understand the meaning of what is commissioned officer.
So the president of India gives commission to the young trainees.
Yeah, Sampan, you want to say? Yes, very correct. So commission is one thing that you get directly from the president of India. Everybody who's done the training, who's become an officer, he gets an ink sign certificate by none other than the President of India. That is, it's not that somebody else is signing for the President. So everybody gets an actual ink signed letter from the President that you are now a commissioned officer. Okay, and this is there in our constitution also. It is there in our Article 14 of our constitution. By this commission, if you are a commissioned officer, you get certain extra rights and privileges. So you have full judicial powers, okay, and social powers over the people you command. So nobody can refuse whatever order you give. That is the power of the commission. See, there are officers in the outside world also. Income tax officer is there, revenue officer is there. But they don't have commission. They are not called as commissioned officers. Here the idea of commission is you have got total control over the men you command. And the second thing is you can never refuse any order. I cannot say ki I don't want to serve in Kashmir because it is very cold there. I am not used to being in some place in Kashmir. Can I say that?
No, sir.
No.
No, sir.
Why? Because you are a commissioned officer means you have to give an oath. You are ready to serve in any part of the country, anytime, even outside the country. You can be told to fight a war maybe in Sri Lanka also. Okay. So you indirectly you are giving a blank check to the government of India. You are signing a blank check of your life and giving it to the government saying, you can use me the way you want to. And indirectly, the government is giving you certain powers over your men, over the people whom you command. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Clear the idea, yes, of sir. Commissioned officer. Okay.
Yes,
once
sir.
You are a commissioned officer, you can use the rank throughout your life. Even after retirement, like both of us, Commander Joe and myself, we are using our ranks. Why are we doing it? Because that is the order, that is the power given by the government of India. Because I am a commissioned officer, so I can use it even if I am a retired person. Because to earn that rank, there is a lot of hard work, blood and sweat that has gone into it. Understood, Sampanna? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, next slide.
Yes, Amir, we have another 5 minutes on this meeting call. Maybe we can finish these things and then we can schedule another one maybe tomorrow or day after.
Yeah, we'll try to finish these qualities and maybe little bit more.
Yeah.
Okay. Then there are leadership qualities, self-confidence, speed of decision, ability to influence a group, and liveliness. Okay. So what is initiative? Initiative means taking the first step. Okay. But this definition of initiative, there are 4 aspects in it. First is you have to take the first step. Then it should be in a new situation or a emerging situation. Third important thing is you should be able to, it should be in the right direction also. Initiative in the wrong direction is not called as initiative. If you see Don, like Dawood Ibrahim say, okay, he has taken initiative, he has got lot of fans following, but is it in the right direction? No.
It
cannot be called as a true initiative. Initiative has to be in the right direction. It should be the first step. And you should be able to maintain it also. There are so many times we take initiative. Yeah, I will start studying from today. But after 5 days, it all goes back to normal again. So you are not able to maintain that initiative. So that is also not complete initiative. Understood? So these 4 points are there in this definition of initiative. Taking the first step in the right direction, okay, and in a new situation, and you should be able to maintain it also. Okay, and initiative does not mean ki you always have to be the leader. Even a leader sometimes follows decision of others. Okay, so in a group activity, whenever you are doing video talk, be ready to follow your teammates also, because sometimes their solutions also can be correct. Then self-confidence, all of you know what is self-confidence, how much of confident you are whenever you are addressing a group, whenever you are taking a step. Speed of decision, very, very important. You should be able to take time, because most of the times in operations, there will be no time to go back. I have never seen any situation in my life if my senior has called me and he has told me, okay, take your own time, planning, make a plan, whatever you resources you want, make a list, I will give you everything, and then I have got to do the work. Always, whenever you will get the work, you will always have less time, you will always have no resources or less resources, but still you will be told to do the work. Fast decision making is very, very important. And in a group, you have to be effective. And liveliness. What is liveliness? Anybody who knows about liveliness? Arnabesh has joined now. Arnabesh, what do you mean? Somebody is very lively. What do you mean by that?
Lively means who is very
cheerful. Indirectly, lively means cheerful. So you should be buoyant enough.
Very cheerful, prompt and active.
Be able to bounce back. Because at every stage you will get setbacks. Understood?
Yes, sir.
Your ability to bounce back is very, very important. And the last slide that we'll go to is the dynamic qualities now. Determination, courage, and stamina. Determination, the most important quality now. One of the most important dynamic qualities. Because sometimes the determination can override intelligence. Even your organizing ability, your planning. My planning might go wrong, but if I am determined, I can still achieve my aims. So many times we have seen that in operations, planning has gone totally wrong. But just because the men were extremely determined, they are able to achieve results. Okay, so determination sometimes overrides others. So it is a very, very important quality. Obviously, courage is required in the armed forces. Courage is also moral courage. Huh? Courage doesn't mean physical courage. It is also moral courage to own up things. If you have done anything wrong, you should be courageous to accept it and take the punishment. And lastly, it is the stamina part, your physical stamina and your mental stamina. Commander Jog might tell you, so many times it happens in the psychological test, your initial responses in the SRTs are good. But as you start ending, after some time, your responses start getting worse. And that is that it directly reflects on your mental stamina, because you are now getting mentally tired and you have started committing a lot of mistakes. Would you like to add on it, sir?
Yeah, I think, you know, both these aspects, physical as well as mental stamina, you know, you have to realize are very, very important. You know, most of the times, you know, one very common example that I use is that, you know, you don't run a marathon with your feet. Okay. Because after some time, once the marathon has started, you know, you start feeling tired and your feet will indicate to your brain that you need to stop. But it is your brain or it is your head that keeps on saying that, you know, no, it is not the time that I can stop and I need to continue. So, you know, physical and mental stamina both are extremely, extremely important when we are talking about the OLQs. Okay. So I think we are almost to the end of this particular meeting. So maybe, you know, I hope all of you got a very good idea of all the OLQs and what they actually mean and what we look for.